So when I want to transition into another abstract that we've gotten data from, and that is that, you know, in all of these trials that we all participated in, we excluded patients that were on higher dose steroids for whatever reason. And that's one of the questions that comes up in clinical practice is how much steroid is too much steroid, and does it really make a difference? So we saw, Ben, a retrospective analysis here. Could you kind of just talk us through that?
Yeah, this will be presented, I believe, on Monday. It's a retrospective analysis from two very large institutions, academic institutions, looking at 640 patients who received single-agent checkpoint inhibitors. And they reviewed the clinical and pharmaceutical records, the pharmacy records and the clinical records, and really identified two groups, those that had received steroids of greater than 10 milligrams of prednisone equivalents versus those that had less than 10 or no steroids. And interestingly, roughly 15% of the patients of the 640 had received greater than 10 milligrams of prednisone, or excuse me, of steroids. And common reasons for having received steroids included fatigue, dyspnea, brain metastases, and I think we'll learn more. But when you adjusted for smoking history, performance status, and brain meds, those patients that had received steroids did far worse than those that did not. Now, I think the devil's in the details with this trial. We need to learn how long they were on them for. But clearly, I mean, this is important. It's trying, albeit in a retrospective way, to answer a very clinically meaningful question, which is, do steroids negate the effect of immunotherapy? And I think based on this data, we can say perhaps, but I think we need to learn a lot more about this data and, again, how long they were on it for. And
I think the central question from this abstract is it the prednisone or is it the protoplasm?
That's right.
Protoplasm.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a retrospective study with all sorts of confounding variables. There is a world of difference between a patient with asymptomatic brain metastasis, minimal vasogenic edema, gets SRS and does not require steroids, from one who is still on steroids off trial because of vasogenic edema. I can assure you that the prognosis in that patient with symptomatic brain mets is far worse than the asymptomatic patient. So that
they adjusted for performance status and brain mets.
Yeah, but
so
not
we'll have
but
the
they're
nature of the brain mets.
Yeah.
Retrospectively, but they tried to do due diligence.
Yeah. And I congratulate them on that, but we really need to burrow into the details of these patients, as you've indicated, to have some sense of, are the steroids really hurting? And remember in 189, frankly, in any study that doesn't use NABPAC, steroids are part of at least the conditioning, the regimen to prevent toxicity.
I think, though, hypothetically, it does make sense, right? We know they're immunosuppressive. And I think it's probably the chronic use of the steroids versus when you give it for a short course with chemotherapy for a couple of days. That's very different from somebody who has chronic use steroids, like a COPD patient who has been on prednisone 20 milligrams for 3 months or something. So, which goes to that protoplasm question that I think you brought up, and I'm gonna kind of take a tangent about antibiotic use as well. Remember that you could not go on to these trials if you had antibiotic use within a couple of weeks. And now we're learning that perhaps that is changing the microbiome, which again goes to the host immune system as well. So I think another interesting retrospective analysis could be to look at that as well. I know I'm kind of going on a tangent, but there have been many scientific articles now in Nature and Science really promoting the microbiome and its importance in immunotherapy and trials that are going to be looking at fecal transplants to, again, do that. So I know I'm off on a tangent here.
No, I think
I think it goes to the point that we still have a lot to learn about the host microbiome, what influences the host microbiome, and then how that influences these immunotherapy agents.
I think the other important point is this should not be a deterrent to the initiation of steroids in patients who are having toxicities. And all of us have treated folks.
Yes.
They've had toxicity. We've been able to wean the steroids down to some acceptable level. I usually try to get it to 10 milligrams, and then I resume the immunotherapy, particularly in individuals who are benefiting. I don't think we need to stake ourselves to completely eliminating steroids.
Right,
in those
but
individuals.
It does. This abstract does remind me that I was trained that you apply the results of a phase 3 trial to the population that was studied, and these patients were excluded. And your point about the antibiotics is a good one. And so I think that that's the take-home message here. Whether it's the prednisone or the protoplasm, I think we can debate. But I think it's to me. I think it's more the protoplasm here. But it reminds us that we just can't broadly apply the results of the trial to populations that were excluded from the initial trials.